Morning, how are y'all feeling?
Better.
Good.
Good.
I
Happy New Year. Welcome to St. Luke's, where spirits come alive. It is a joy to welcome all of you to worship this morning on this Epiphany Sunday. Epiphany means to reveal, and the wise men, when they arrived at the manger, revealed Jesus as the Savior to the nations. So that is our festival today, Epiphany, revealing Jesus as the Savior to the nations. It's the tradition to bless the sanctuary and to bless our homes, because the wise men, as they entered the home where Jesus was, they brought blessing and gifts. And so we will bless the sanctuary today as our opening liturgy. And we also have two things for you to take home. One is this little kit, so you can bless your own home and do a chalking of your door as a blessing for the new year. And the second thing we have is a star word, and those are on the tables as you will depart from Holy Communion. And I will say more about that at, with a sermon. It's a guiding word, so a blessing for the home and a blessing for you personally as we begin this new year. And this is all part of our Epiphany celebration. So we say a warm welcome to you for this Epiphany celebration and to those who are joining us on streaming. And if you would like any of these things, the chalking the door blessing for your home or a star word, you can let us know in the comments or by emailing us, and we will mail you these things if you're joining us from home. For now, I'd like you to get out your attendance slip, fill it out, and save it to put it in the offering plate if you're joining us in person. If you're joining us from home, give us a shout out in the comments to register your attendance. If you're a guest or a visitor, then please leave us your cell phone or your email. I'd love to take you out to coffee and get to know your story. If you're a guest on Zoom joining us from home on streaming, then I'd like to get together with you on Zoom. Or if you're local, I'd also like to take you out to coffee, so please get in touch. We will serve Holy Communion today, and everyone is welcome at the table of the Lord. I will give instructions later in the service for those in person. And if you're joining us from home, please get a piece of bread or a cracker and some wine, juice, or water to join us in the celebration of the Lord's Supper. We begin in rising in body or spirit, and we will gather at the front door for our Epiphany blessing. To begin the blessing of the sanctuary. So you can rise in body or spirit and turn and face the main door. So Michael Packer, whose birthday it is today, is going to be the one standing on the step ladder to bless the door. All right, so I'm going to begin. Mike, on the frame above the door, it says 20 plus C plus M plus B plus 24 for the year. And the letters C, M, B stands for Christus Mansionem Benedicat, which is Latin for May Christ Bless This Dwelling. C and B can also stand for the 9th century names of the three magi who came to the manger: Caspar, Melchior, and Balthazar. And it is tradition to bless our house of worship and also our homes at Epiphany. And that's the festival, as we've said, of the wise men arriving at the manger. Let us pray together. O God, you revealed your Son to all people by the shining light of a star. We pray that you bless this sanctuary and all who will worship here this year with the light of your presence. May your love be our inspiration, your wisdom our guide, your truth our light, and your peace our benediction, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Okay, we are going to continue with a procession through the sanctuary to begin our blessing. So we'll start right here at the back. O Christ, bless this house, this place of worship and praise. Now we'll process to the middle. O Christ, bless this house, this place of worship and praise. Now we'll go to the base of the steps. O Christ, bless this worship space and all who pray and sing here. Now we go to the font. O Christ, bless this baptismal font, this place of washing by your word. And now Levi is going to light our baptismal candle. Okay, we might need to have you come up the steps so we can reach that wick. There we go. Good job. Wonderful. Now we're going to go over to the pulpit. O Christ, bless this pulpit, this place of sounding forth your word. And now we go to the altar. O Christ, bless this table, this place of feasting on your life. And now Levi will light the altar candles. And now we join in our gathering song, We Three Kings of Orient Are. The forgiveness of our Lord Jesus Christ, the power of God, and the light of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. O God, on this day you revealed your Son to the nations by the leading of a star.
Lead us now by faith to know your presence in our lives and bring us at last to the full vision of your glory through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
You may be seated. I invite the children to join Levi and me up here on the steps, along with anyone else who's young at heart, our teenagers. We're so excited for our children's message from Pastor Janet about stars and light and what we're doing today for Luke's learners. Would you like me to hold the microphone?
Okay,
you're okay today. Great.
Well, good morning. And good morning to you all.
Good morning.
Good morning. And Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
So today, Levi and I and Bryn are going on a treasure hunt.
Oh.
Because I found a treasures map. And the treasure map is for Luke's learners. And it says on here, now probably I need to get over the microphone.
All right.
It says on here, follow the stars to get to the treasures. So we're going to find, see if we can find some treasures to take to King Jesus. And look at our map. It looks like a map of the church. How about that? Okay, Levi, hold on to the map so we can follow it. And Bryn's got something for us to take our treasures
yes.
in. Here's one of the stars. We're going to be looking for stars like this. And we're going to line them up. And we're going to find the treasures to take to the manger.
Ooh.
Then we'll see what happens there. Okay? We'll see if we can find good treasures. I don't think we'll find gold, frankincense, or myrrh. But we'll find some good treasures to take to the baby Jesus. Sound good? All right, here we go.
All right, sounds awesome. Okay, thank you, Pastor Janet. All right, you can go ahead with your treasure map and go find the treasure. All right, Natalie's going too, so is Ashley. Sounds fun. All right, we continue with our reading.
A reading from Ephesians. This is the reason that I, Paul, am a prisoner for Christ Jesus for the sake of you Gentiles. For surely you have already heard of the commission of God's grace that was given me for you, and how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I wrote above in a few words, a reading of which will enable you to perceive my understanding of the mystery of Christ. In former generations, this mystery was not made known to humankind, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. That is, the Gentiles have become fellow heirs, members of the same body, and sharers in the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel, I have become a servant according to the gift of God's grace that was given me by the working of his power. Although I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to me to bring to the Gentiles the news of boundless riches of Christ, and to make everyone see what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church, the wisdom of God in its rich variety might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose that he has carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have access to God in boldness and confidence through faith in him. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, so as it has been written by the prophet. And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. And when they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. This is the gospel of the Lord. The first couple of weeks of January can be, mental torture. If you're like me, and I hope and pray that you are not, you vacillate between a radical list of self-improvement resolutions to whip yourself back into shape on the one hand, and then on the other, you're thinking maybe by now you're old enough for this to be the year of kinder self-acceptance. Then I try harder at all the necessary self-improvements, which are many. And when I flunk at something in the first week of the year, I think more about self-acceptance, but then all the things that I need to improve come crashing into my head because I live not just with a regular garden variety critic, but with a prosecutor, judge, and jury that is always raising a case against me in my head. And then I wonder who made up New Year's resolutions anyway. And I can decide to make a change any day of the week, any hour of the day, and around we go. Maybe you are a rock star at New Year's resolutions. I'm glad. And if you get nothing else out of today, you can thank the good Lord that you do not live in my head. It's a dangerous neighborhood, and on many days, I should not go there alone. Which is why I am glad that our text today has some wise folk in it. Because I need some wisdom at the beginning of the year, and don't we all? I hope I'm not alone in this. Wisdom about how to feel worthy to come before the Lord. How to be worthy of love. Not just our Savior's love, but anyone's love. We need wisdom on how to see God's presence here. And are New Year's resolutions really necessary after all? Gosh, I hope not. The Bible text says that these travelers coming to see Jesus were wise men. But that's not necessarily so. The original language just says magos, from which we get the word magi. It refers to teachers, priests, astrologers, or seers, who probably came from Persia, which is modern-day Iran. They were Zoroastrians, an ancient religion dating back to 1500 BCE. And yes, they watched the stars. Most likely, there were women in their company who had these spiritual gifts or who were at least traveling with them. Our pictures always just show three guys, but obviously three people didn't travel alone. They needed a whole company of people to succeed traveling cross country. In fact, I have a kitchen towel that a friend gave me, and it says that after the wise men showed up, the wise women came in, and they brought extra diapers, casserole, and a bottle of wine. Whatever our gender, we can all see ourselves in this story, all invited to the manger with the magi. And so, what do these wise magi of yesteryear have to teach us on the doorstep of 2024? They did several things, but today we will focus on two. They trusted God to show up. And number two, they paused for joy. First, the Magi believed that God would show up in the everyday, and they spent their lives watching for it. This belief was not based on their worthiness or anyone's worthiness. They trusted God to show up because that was the nature of God. As spirit, God needed physical matter in order to be seen. And so it was God's business to appear in the physical world so we could see glimpses, God sightings, God winks, experiencing the sacred. We are worthy because all of creation is worthy, made by the Creator. Psalm 139 proclaims, "For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works that I know very well." Did you or I follow our resolutions today? Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter to our worthiness. God is showing up because that is what God does. For you, Rick, for you, Bill, for you, Wanda, for you, Jeannie, for you, Perry, for every one of you, and for me. The only question is where? Where is God showing up today? Do we hear God, taste God in a great meal with friends? Do we feel God in our chest, in our gut? Do we see God, experience God, hear a still small voice, notice something in nature, listen to a child, meet a different person, notice a new star? How is the sacred pulling back the curtain today and giving us a wink? Where is God being made known? It's always there for each of us. We just get to notice, to pay attention, and to give God the credit and the grace moments and the praise. There's no such thing as a coincidence. That's a God sighting. Now you can rethink all the times you said, "Oh, that was a coincidence." No. Isaiah 41 promises us, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my victorious right hand." The Magi devoted their life to this assurance of seeing God in their everyday and paying close attention to God's sightings. They watched the stars and they found one that shone brightly and differently, and they knew that God was showing up. So often when I need encouragement, a bird or a butterfly will fly right in front of my car, or they will land right next to my parking space at the store, or they will sit on my windowsill at home. This has happened, so it happened right before Christmas at the parking lot. There was a bird right there where I was parking, and then it moved, and then it started singing. And when I walked out of the car this morning, walked out of the house to get to the car, the first thing I heard as I stepped out was this beautiful bird song. And I looked to the right, and at the very tippy top of this very tall tree in my neighbor's yard, I could see a red chest of a bird singing. The Magi got so close, but could not find the baby Jesus. They did something very radical, especially if they were three men. They stopped and asked for directions. Sorry. Women also don't like to ask for directions. I don't like to ask for help. We often forget that God shows up when we ask for directions or any kind of help. It takes wisdom to ask for help. The Magi never would have found Jesus if they didn't find out that the Savior was to be born in Bethlehem. They'd still be walking in circles around the Holy Land. Remember this the next time your GPS stops working or your phone runs out of battery. It takes wisdom to ask for help. So the Magi made it to Bethlehem, and the second wise thing they do is to pause for joy. When they saw the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. After a long journey and stopping for directions, you would think that they would rush in to see what God was doing and to see Jesus. But no, the Magi paused so we can stop with them and experience the joy of God breaking into our human story with the biggest God sighting ever, with the face of God in a baby. Pausing for joy means savoring the moment so we can really experience and embrace and share in God's presence. It is a pause to show up ourselves when God shows up for us. In these moments, my husband Dan says, "I need a moment to allow my emotions to catch up with my intuition." The Magi knew intuitively that they were about to see the Savior. So they paused for joy to allow their emotions to catch up so that they were fully available. They did not want to leave and have that awful experience of having little memory of that significant moment because they were not really present. We've all had that, haven't we? That moment where it was really one of those significant moments, but we can't remember it because we were distracted. We were thinking of something else. We weren't fully present. So allow your whole system to come online. Body, mind, heart, spirit, pause for joy. Show up with your whole self for God when God shows up for you. After Jesus told the disciples to abide in him as he abides in God in the Gospel of John, Jesus says, "I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be made complete." God desires us to have joy in Jesus. Not that our life is perfect or that everything is working out as we had hoped, but that amid life as it is, God keeps breaking in with love. God keeps showing up with forgiveness and hope in some way, in some form. And we can also show up and be fully present with God and pause for joy. This is where we tend to rush the story and we jump to gold and frankincense and myrrh. But first, notice that the Magi brought only themselves. They knelt and worshiped, full of joy. They responded to seeing God's presence. They first brought their own hearts, their full, flawed, without resolutions other than to show up, worthy because God made them, pausing for joy, fully present selves. I invite you to close your eyes for a moment and to kneel with the Magi there. God shows up for you in the birth of Jesus. Take a deep breath. Show up as yourself, fully as you are. And maybe deeper, fuller, self-acceptance is resolution enough. You are worthy because God made you, and Jesus loves you. You are worthy of love and of being loved by others. That's why a baby in a manger, it's pure love. And it's easier to embrace self-acceptance, worthiness, peace, kneeling here. No resolutions needed. Keep your eyes closed. Only after offering this, their fully flawed, fully present selves to Jesus, did the Magi give their offering of gifts and gratitude. What gift of gratitude do you want to offer? You can give that gift to Jesus now in your mind's eye. Does the Spirit of Jesus say something back to you? Let the love fill your whole body. When you're ready, you could open your eyes. And I thank you. When the Magi departed from the manger, they kept trusting God to show up. And God did keep showing up. That night in a dream, with instructions to go home a different way. As you depart from here today, I invite you to also go home a different way, with a different way of being, a kinder, gentler way of being yourself in the new year, one of fuller acceptance, being made by a loving creator, one of deeper worthiness, embraced by the God who shows up behind every sunset and every bird, winking at you from creation, loving you behind every kind word and embrace from someone. One of greater hope, filled with love that pours from the manger and grace that flows from the cross. One of firmer faith, strengthened by the life that bursts from the tomb and fills us at this table. And then for your second God sighting, or third maybe, I hope, after the love and the life that you receive from our Lord's Supper, I invite you to pick up a star word or two for the coming year off the tables as you return from the communion. And they're all turned over, which means you don't pick one consciously. You just trust the Holy Spirit. You trust Jesus to have you pick up the word or two that God wants you to have this year and see how this word might inform what God is doing in your life and how God is inviting you to grow this year. Last year, I picked two words and I taped them to my mirror. They're still there. I haven't taken them down until I get a couple more this year. And I couldn't figure out sort of the significance of these two words almost the whole year. And toward the last two or three months of the year, it started to make sense to me. So I'm very curious to find out what the two words are that I'm going to receive this year. And like I said, for those at home, shoot us an email, give us a shout out on the comments, and we will say a prayer for you and pick a word or two and put them in the mail. And then I invite you to remember to notice God's sightings and to pause for joy, not as a resolution, but because you are worthy. You are worthy of seeing God show up for you, and you are worthy of showing up for God. Let the people say amen. The Spirit of the Lord is poured out upon us in abundance, so we are bold to pray for the church, the world, and all that God has made. You may kneel in body or spirit. You can be seated if that is more comfortable. As we settle into our prayer positions, we pray for Max Ashby, who has entered hospice at home, Ted Bender, who is in ICU in Allen. We also pray continually for Joy Minty, whose daughter died the week before Christmas. Her death has now been ruled a homicide. We are grateful for Pastor Shirley of Trinity Lutheran Church in Pasadena, a connection we have through Pastor Janet, who will be ministering to Joy and her family as they go to L.A. when the body is released. Let us pray. Give us the eyes of faith to notice your presence showing up in our daily life, in creation, in other people, in unexpected blessings, in all experiences of love, hope, and goodness. Help us to pause for joy, accepting that you make us worthy to receive your love, and showing up with our whole selves as we embrace the love of Jesus from the manger to the cross, to the empty tomb, to this table. God of grace, hear our prayer. Establish justice on earth for all its inhabitants. Lead us, O God, to protect fragile ecosystems and endangered species. Make us careful stewards of your creation, even as we assist those suffering from severe storms, floods, drought, and other effects of climate change. God of grace, hear our prayer. Nations shall come to your light and kings to your dawning. We pray for this day to come quickly, Lord, especially for nations at war. nations suffering from gang violence that causes people to flee and other oppressive environments. We grieve the gun violence in our own nation. We pray for your justice to roll down like waters and your righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. God of grace, hear our prayer. Defend the cause of all who are in need, facing poverty, and all who are without homes or safety. Bring healing to those who are ill, in body, mind, or spirit, and strengthen them with your loving presence, especially Bill and Michelle, Ed and Carol, Annie, Jim and Linda, Ralph, Max and Beverly, Irene, Shella, Joy, Tassos, Lauren, Ted, Larry, Roger, Jay, Sarah, and those we name in our hearts and aloud now. God of grace, hear our prayer. You have redeemed the lives of your faithful departed, especially Ken Siegman, Zara Minty, and Sandy Cloutier. Through the love of Christ, gather us into one body with them, and gather us all to the joy of our eternal home with you. Bring comfort, especially to the Minty family, to the Bakner family, and to the Anderson Cloutier family. God of grace, hear our prayer. Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all of our prayers to you in confidence and faith through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And now may the peace of the risen Christ be with you always. Please rise in body or spirit and turn and face the balcony and wave a sign of peace to those joining us on streaming and serving in audio and technology. Then please wave a sign of peace or shake hands with those who are worshiping near you. Learn the name of somebody near you if you don't know them yet. You may be seated for the offering. We're so grateful for all of the gifts that support the mission of our outreach here at St. Luke's. If you're joining us on streaming, you can mail in your offering or go to our website and click give. Those worshiping in person can also use the QR code in the bulletin. Thank you for your generosity. Thank you.
Let us pray together. Merciful God, receive the gifts we bring, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Through this meal, unite us as your body, shining with the light of your justice and mercy, so that others may experience your presence breaking into this world. In Jesus' name, amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. In the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and we join their unending hymn. One, the beginning and the end, the giver of life. Blessed are you for the birth of creation. Blessed are you in the darkness and in the light. Blessed are you for your promise to your people. Blessed are you in the prophet's hopes and dreams. Blessed are you for Mary's openness to your will. Blessed are you for your son, Jesus, the Word made flesh. Those joining us from home can lift your elements with the words of institution. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming. Come, Lord Jesus. Holy God, we long for your spirit. Come among us. Bless this meal. Make your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. Come, Holy Spirit. All praise and glory are yours, Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, power of the Most High, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Come to the banquet, for all is now ready. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. This is the Lord's table, and everyone is welcome, regardless of church background or denomination. Please come up the center aisle to receive the bread from me or Pastor Mark. You can ask for a gluten-free bread if you need that. Then you proceed to the communion server on the same side in which you're sitting. You can have white grape juice if you prefer that to the red wine. Return to your seat by the side aisle, throwing away your cup in the trash by the front pew. Pick up your star word or two on the table as you return to your seat by the side aisle. If you cannot come forward, it is my pleasure to serve you in the pew at the end. Those joining us from home can receive communion now. Take and eat the body of Christ given for you. Take and drink. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. rise in body or spirit for the blessing. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray together. We thank you, O God, that you have strengthened our hearts through this feast of life and salvation. Shine the light of Christ on our path, that we may do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you, now and forever. Amen.
Stay after church if you can today and help us put away all the beautiful decorations, saving them for next year. Next week after church, I'm teaching St. Luke's 101. For those who are new to the community, we're having pizza, so let me know if you're coming. And also, Luke's learners have gone on their treasure hunt, so we're going to be looking for them to come up front with their stars and help us with our closing hymn. So here they come. All right, they're going to come up front. And now receive the final blessing. May the God of grace dwell in you richly, name you beloved, and shine brightly on your path. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Creator, the Christ, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.
Shaker. Here we go. They're ready to dance. My kind of people.
This little light of love,
justice, love kindness, and walk humbly, shining the light of Christ as you love, serve, and welcome all. Thanks be to God, and we will.